Welcome back to Passion World Talk Radio Network, a wholly owned subsidiary of Global Media Network, LLC, which means Limited Liability Company, in case you don't work in the business world, which means if you're sued, you're somewhat protected. But if you want to really protect yourself, you go get yourself a business lawyer. Okay. Educate, enlighten, and entertain. Hosts are Vicky Esther Chang from Singapore and I, Lillian Sarah Caldwell. Take it away, Vicky.
Hi, everyone. I'm so excited to be launching the first inaugural episode, EP1 of State of Business and Technology, in short, State of BizTech. Here in Singapore, we call it BizTech. So this is a spin-off from our emerging successful seasons, the shows of State of Current Affairs and State of Our World. And I'm very, very sure this is going to take everyone on a very exciting ride. We're going to talk about business. We're going to introduce who the CEOs are, who the companies are, what they do, how much wealth they hold. Again, this is business. It's all about money, right? Where I'm going to introduce economic terminologies. What does GDP constitute? What is the components of a GDP? Because we hear so much about that. What's a treasury bill? What bonds are? What Robert Kiyosaki says, because he's such a contentious person. Again, about Bitcoin, the technology front, we're going to talk about some of the newest lexicals, new vocabulary that's just come up. What are Bitcoins? What is a blockchain? What are large language models? What are big data, artificial intelligence, generative AI, super intelligence, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And we're going to talk about these that will impact our lives, particularly people like us, the mainstream people, because we don't belong to the 1% of the world, the top 1% of the world. And we're going to talk about the top 1% of the world in the show, who they are. A lot of them, I think, they are known, but they also want to be less known because of security issues. They don't want to be, they don't want to have their lives cut short because of ransom, because their lives, their children's lives, etc. But we're going to talk about them. We're going to talk about some of these companies, and also I'm going to introduce business concepts. Some of these business concepts, like what is blue ocean, what is red ocean, competition, forces determining a business, how do you enter a market, how should you exit a market, how do you build your brand, how do you get the intangible value from your business besides your P&L, besides your customers and your database. How else can you get value and sell your business at a value that you think it's that is deserving, besides just the tables and the chairs, the assets. So we'll talk more about that. And we're going to devote our time about the biggest, richest company in the world right now. We're talking about NVIDIA. We're talking about SpaceX, Tesla, and these are the companies that's reached $1 trillion market capitalization status. So we're going to talk about that. And we're going to talk about some of these controversies about the chip market. Why is the chip market, the supply chain, such a huge, is causing such a huge contentious issue in the world? It is almost a geopolitical issue right now. When the world fights for resources, they did fight for resources, right? When they wanted the oil and the timber, and now they're still fighting. Yeah, they're going to fight for raw material, for batteries, for things that power your phones, that things that power your EVs, your electrical vehicles. So we're going to talk about that. Hopefully the articles will come, and then we're going to report about that. And today we're going to roll out, firstly, these are the terms that I think people who are tuning in should know. They are the names that are thrown around in Bloomberg, in the capital market. They are in the top 1% of the world. They hold 1% of the world's wealth and assets. And we're going to talk also a bit about business and tech, where business intersects technology. And then we're going to talk about pure technology. So we're going to go on this ride, and hopefully I will refine my reporting as the days go. Write to us what you would like to hear and give us feedback and tell us what are the takeaways at the end of like 20 minutes. Do you want to know more? Of course, we can't delve in too much into it. We touch and go, but hopefully you understand the concepts. We've talked about Blue Zone yesterday on State of Current Affairs. You know, you get a new concept, you've got a new understanding, you've got a new education. So hopefully, again, State of Business and Technology, we bring to you what's current, what impacts your life, and what impacts the world. First article, Larry Fint. And this is, we know that the word right now, the person right now is Elon Musk, right? He has gone from being the tech guru to being the one of your president's right-hand person, right-hand man, and he's going to clean up the finances of the government spending. But Elon Musk is it's been calculated, his wealth has been calculated right now to be the wealthiest man on the surface of the earth, holding almost $1 trillion. It's the first person who touched that number. That's another person who touched that number, holding $1 trillion wealth, and that's Jensen Huang, another person who holds the key to artificial intelligence. But we're not going to talk about both of them. We're going to talk about another person that's probably under the radar, but a lot of people will know him if you watch a lot of investment shows on Bloomberg, CNBC, MSNBC, etc. His name is Larry Fint, and I think you know that. Some of you may have heard about him, but you've not seen his face, but his name is always floated around. Everyone wants to know who's the richest man on earth. Meet this guy. Meet Larry Fint. And you can find this article in www.india.com. India, I-N-D-I-A.com. India.com. Meet Larry Fint, who is richer than Elon Musk, Jeff Bezos, Bill Gates, Mukesh Mambani, an Indian billionaire, richer than any of them. He can buy half of USA, many countries, and many countries' net worth. Let's talk about this guy. There's a picture here if you look at the click. He just looks like any dad, you know. But hey, this guy, Larry Fint, going to talk a little bit about him. Elon Musk, Jeff Bezos, or Bill Gates are some of the world's most renowned billionaires across the globe. However, there is someone richer than these personalities in America, but yet to feature in any of the billionaire lists. Larry Fint is the CEO of BlackRock, the world's largest asset management company, which overseas assets worth US dollar 7.4 trillion. The company and only company that holds that amount of wealth, and that is 7.4 trillion US dollars. He manages the largest pool of public funds. And as of December 2024, now, on this date, his company, BlackRock, market capitalization stands at over trillion of dollars. These asset management firms engage in mutual funds business where people invest their money. These firms like BlackRock invest in companies across the globe. BlackRock's assets under management have reached a staggering 11.5 US trillion. And under its asset management operations, BlackRock controls a pool of public funds that exceeds the GDP of many countries. So I think everyone has heard about BlackRock. I mean, the Singapore Sovereign Fund that has over billions and billions of dollars, and we're talking about sovereign fund, that means a country's wealth under the sovereignty of the government is allowed to invest. This fund is called the Sovereign Fund, and Singapore Sovereign Fund called Temasek Holdings worked very closely with BlackRock for investments. And BlackRock, of course, is one of the favorite investors for many, many governments, sovereign funds all around the world. So this guy today, we're going to learn about him. His name is Larry Fink, and he is the man that seldom gets featured in the headlines. He doesn't hold a technology company. He is the CEO of the world's largest asset management. I mean, asset management could be investing in property, in stocks, in shares, in companies, in startups, in anything, innovations. So that's asset management. So today we're going to introduce some of these people to you. If you do hear about Larry Fink from now, remember that you learned it from State of Business and Technology. The other person that I would like to introduce to you, another really, really famous person. This person, you see him almost daily. Just let me pull up the article. You watch him almost daily. You would have seen him. You may not have heard about him. His name is Jamie Dimon. But if you look at him, definitely you will come across this guy. Because this guy, this gentleman, he is the CEO of the company, JP Morgan. And why does he hit the headlines lately? Much more so than before. In the past, it's always in the business news because it's always in commenting about the economy, about stocks, about the trends in business. This man was courting to be the treasury, the Secretary of Treasury of the United States under Kamala Harris. And now he is in talks with Donald Trump to form some of these very important policies for economics. So this man is so, not only is really rich, not only is one of the richest guys, men on earth, the top 1% of the surface of the world, he is being caught by politicians, Kamala Harris and also Donald Trump right now. And a little bit about what he says. Now, this gentleman, a little bit about his background. If you find him on Wikipedia, Jamie Dimon was born on March the 13th, 1956. He's an American businessman who has been the chairman and the chief executive of officer J.P. Morgan Chase since 2006. He began his career as a management consultant in Boston Consulting Group, a really, really famous business consulting group that has presence in Singapore also and many places in the world, and also Boston, right? He got his MBA from Harvard Business School in 1982, and he joined American Express. So that's a little bit about his background, looking below. But what's interesting is, I'm going to pull up the article from AOL.com that says, just waiting for it to load, that Donald Trump has secretly been communicating with Jamie Dimon about White House agenda for months. He's seeking, of course, both sides are trying to seek a position for him to be in the economic board of some sort, maybe the Secretary of Treasury. You can see the picture here. He's always on television. But I'm going to also talk about what he says. Really interesting. Now, this man, 1%, holds 1% of the wealth in the world, JP Morgan Chase, and also caught by Donald Trump and Kamala Harris. He says, the next generation of employees will work 3.5 days a week and live to 100 years old. So that article is in yahoofinance.com. You can find it at yahoofinance.com. JP Morgan CEO Jamie Dimon is shaking off doomsday predictions about what AI means for humanity, instead laying out how he sees technology vastly improving businesses and work-life balance for their employees. Even Dimon, Jamie Dimon, a fierce advocate of long-established career norms such as working hard and being prepared for anything and working in the office, says future generations of employees could work a day and a half less every week thanks to AI. So, and he also says that he predicts that the future people in general could live, on the average, could live beyond 100 years old. So these are the two topics we talked about in our show, State of Current Affairs. We talked about yesterday the trends and the movement of longevity and don't die. So this gentleman in his 60s, late 60s, I think he's thinking of longevity and don't die. He's really thinking of pushing the boundaries that, you know, people are going to live beyond 100 years old. And I hope so if you do have good health and you do have a good quality of health. But one thing he said really, really interestingly, that is so different from what we have heard and what we have said and discussed in the past few weeks about generative AI, about the fears, about how it's going to threaten humanity. He's one of the few exceptions that really is positive about AI, a much more so positive than people in the technology world, like from Elon Musk's standpoint. If you look at what is said throughout the years, it says that AI should be regulated. AI is going to do more damage because they're going to take over the world, and super singularity and super intelligence is going to take on the world in the foreseeable future. However, he's the only one that stands out, and this comes from one of the richest men on earth. He says that thanks to AI, people are going to work 3.5 days per week. And he's one of the people that is positive. And I'm going to just pose this question to the viewers and the listeners, because there's such a big debate. And for our State of Business and Technology, we open the question to you. This is an open question. Do you agree or not that the world and lives of workers in general are going to be better or not? Yes or no, vote, and then state your reasons. Write to Lillian Cardwell and then write to myself about this argument, whether AI is going to be better for workers, better for humanity, or worse for humanity and worse for workers. The floor is yours. Write to below, or you can text below to Lillian. We want to hear you telling us the Main Street opinion about the future, because we have a stake in it. We are the stakeholders of our lives in the future, and robotics and AI is going to affect all of us. So again, here, Jamie Dimon says he's the lone voice. I hear that AI is going to be good for humanity and we're going to work less. And my take is that for Lillian and for the viewers and the listeners, my take is if you are going to work 3.5 days instead of 5 days or 5.5 days, does it mean that your salary is going to be reduced in correlation? And does it mean in equitable numbers of working labor man hours, does it mean that the company can reduce the number of workers because they can shorten the days? So I'm just going to pose that to the viewers. I think Lillian agrees that we should engage our listeners and our viewers, and we should poll you, yes or no, on the average. Of course, technology helps us like this podcast. So yes or no, only one vote, right? One man, one vote. No standing in between. Your take on it in general, 50% more, yes, or 50% more, no. That's it, right? So that's the vote for you. So with that, when business and technology merge, like what Jamie Dimon says, his take is that AI is going to help his business. And I have a thinking that his employees are paid millions and millions and millions of dollars because they are the wealth managers, managing the wealth of this high net worth individuals, billions and billions of dollars. Definitely, if he's going to cut their salary, he's going to be happy, right? So I'm just going to think about these richest men on earth, what they think about AI is going to impact on their business. I think they've got a healthy bottom line. They wouldn't have to be afraid that AI will take over their job or their wealth. So from there, I'm going to go over to the next article, Pure Technology. We've talked about two of the wealthiest people. And if there's any takeaway, you learned about Larry Fink. You also learn about Jamie Dimon and the technology part. And I've got three articles for you. I've done three research for our listeners and our viewers. This boy, 14 years old. The article is from CNN Business, CNN.com. Go to CNN.com and go to business. Mom describes the dark exchange her son had with a chat bot. That means a robot. The mother, Megan Garcia, is suing AI chatbot company Character.ai after her 14-year-old son, who was a frequent user, died by suicide. She alleges the platform lacks the proper safeguards for young users and that her son was talking to his chatbot about self-harm when he took his own life. And there's another article beyond CNN.com from New York Post. You can find that from NYPost.com about the boy. Boy, 14 years old, fell in love with chatbot, then killed himself after AI app told him to come home to her. Means kill yourself, die, come over to the AI world. So the boy, 14-year-old Florida boy from Florida, killed himself after a lifelike Game of Thrones chatbot he's been messaging for months on an artificial intelligence app sent him an eerie message telling him to come home to her. And the boy's name is Sewell Witzer, committed suicide at his Orlando home in February after becoming obsessed and allegedly falling in love with the chatbot character. So you can find many articles about this boy, how he killed himself after chatting with the robot because the robot keep urging him to take his life and go over to her side. So that's two articles for you. You can find that on nypost.com and cnnbusiness.com. And one more article, a similar article on finance.yahoo.com. An AI chatbot prompted a 14-year-old's suicide, and mom's lawsuit alleges there is no guardrails for children. Now there's more and more articles reporting it from different sites and different facts and details have emerged that this really is the case of an AI bot telling a boy to take his life. So there again, ladies and gentlemen, we are posing today on a cliffhanger for you. You make your vote and you make your choice. There's some people who think that AI is going to make business better and the workers' life better. Some people say that AI is dangerous. And one of them is the mother of a 14-year-old boy who has taken his life after chatting with an AI bot. And I'm going to leave everyone with this because we are 26 minutes into the first launch of the EP. I've got two videos below if you were to go to the link. The first video is a show from Bloomberg.tv or Bloomberg TV. It's called Post Human. And ladies and gentlemen, you can do a lot of research, not only now from text, which is news articles. You can also watch the news on television. You can also watch the news on YouTube and Instagram, etc. Now, on this, as I am researching about the dynamics of our discussion, about the relationship between technology and humanity, I found a lot of astounding issues. And this is what is going to frame the direction of our series here, State of Business and Technology, because we're going to bring to you two different sides of the argument, the good, the ugly, the bad. Well, we don't know the truth or not, because we're going to present to you, because this is evolving, this is emerging. People are saying A, some people are saying B, some people are saying X, Y, Z, and some people are saying A, B, C. So we're going to present both sides to you. In this particular research done by a famous reporter or journalist at Bloomberg.tv, she has done the show for 2 years. It's called Post Human, P-O-S-T-H-U-M-A-N. Here, they have researched about the different technology, different companies, different apps, and the development of robotics and AI. And she came to this robotics company that is actually teaching the robotics with a face like this. She's, you look at this. That is a robot. It's teaching the robot, they call it the fifth generation of face communication of the robot, whereby they train the robot to have expressions like muscular stretch and muscular tightening of the muscles so that they can speak and they can have expressions likened to a real life human. And in this show, in this investigation, the AI scientist is into its fifth generation of face robot. So they place the robot in front of the mirror for 5 hours. And at the end of the 5th hour, the robot that is only connected to a lot of wires, to electricity, of course, the AI at the end of the 5th hour, they are able to make expressions without any human intervention, like a human. And then they gave the AI YouTube television to watch all the television for another X number of hours. And at the end, the AI robot is able to make expressions, laugh, frown, speak, right? Exactly like a human. And the video shows it in such an astounding way that the robot you're talking to is just like communicating with you. Now, there's another video below the text. The investigator posed the question to the AI scientist. So, do robots right now have self-awareness? Or they already have awareness of the environment, remember? Because robots can move their hands when it comes to an obstacle they can go over. They already have environmental awareness. When they are being blocked, they can go over, they can go under, they can go left and right, and they can crawl and they could jump and they could run. That means the robot by itself is able to detect the environment already. So it has the intelligence of being able to survive in an environment without human intervention. So the next question is, at the next generation of the robots, will they have self-awareness and conscious awareness? Now, this is the most astounding part by the scientists. At this point in time, robots already learned self-awareness like a child. Think about that. Not like a human being that way up, like a 30-year-old educated person, but like a child. So I'm going to end this note. It could be horrifying. It could be intelligent, depending on how you decipher what I just said. Robots are different from AI, so we're going to talk about it next week. The difference between artificial intelligence and robotics, they are different. Robots are machines. AIs are actually apps and intelligence like chatbots and like GPT. The next frontier is to put AI, artificial intelligence, into robotics to merge them. So you've got machines that has super intelligence. They can decipher the environment and they have self-awareness, meaning you can ask them questions. What are you thinking now? And the robot can, and in the investigation, the robot says, I'm thinking about escape. So think about that, ladies and gentlemen. It's 32 minutes. I've reported a lot of things, a lot of dimensions. I hope this is a cliffhanger to everyone. A robot in its fifth generation has already self-awareness like a child. That's one thing. Number two, there's a debate between different factions of schools of thought. AI is going to be good for you, and AI is going to be bad for you. AI is going to be fearful. It's going to create fear in you. Or AI is something that is not to be feared against. So I'm going to give this to you, and we ask for your vote. Call in or text the number below, and also write to the email below to Lillian and tell us what is your fear, and are you for or against AI, and are you voting for or against AI that is better or worse for humanity. Lillian, I hope this is a good show for our listeners and the viewers for EP1, episode 1, leaving everyone at a cliffhanger. Hopefully everyone will stick around for State of Business and Technology next Wednesday, and also State of Current Affairs with Lillian Cutwell and myself. Lillian, over to you.
Thank you. All right, ladies and gentlemen, you have your call to action to vote, to be or not to be afraid, of course. And the only thing to fear is fear itself. So now you have two things to worry about. Artificial intelligence, robots, self-awareness as a child, and thermonuclear war. Let's see how many more fears we can add on before the end of the year. And then we're all going to turn around and count our blessings. Yes, isn't this a
wonderful? Hello, tell everyone about your Ruby AI, Lillian.
Oh, yes. One of these shows that companies that are sponsoring this program, State of Business and Technology, is Ruby AI. And you can do a quick demo. Go see what it is. Yes, it's artificial intelligence, but it's everything in one app. You do not have to go and bounce around the internet. Everything, as they used to say, it's in there. and you should go and try it out. So it's http://AIwithLillian.com and go take a look and then sign up for a monthly program. I understand that there are other programs out there, but you have to kind of hop along different sectors of the internet to obtain their services. Whereas for one price of the month, so just go or contact me at pwrnetworkllc@gmail.com and I will send you a short 2-minute video so you can take an appropriate look, or you can come in and I can share my screen with you and give you a cursory look. But it's, I've been with it now for 4 months. It is a time saver. What used to take me a year takes me an hour. And by using keywords and key phrases, well, you can find anything you want at Lillian's restaurant. Ever think of that? Probably not. Go away, Lillian. Anyway, it really is a no-brainer. They're already making children take it at school and attaching it to their academic curriculum. And you have to be AI proficient before you graduate. And that's just in 2024.
You have to be AI proficient before you graduate. Is that a criteria already?
Yeah, they're already doing it. They're already, my grandkids have been introduced to it. And my grandson plays chess with AI. Because he really enjoys playing chess. I'm no fun because I keep on forgetting what all those things are supposed to do and I get confused. So AI is a little smarter than I am, which is fine with me. So you ought to check it out. You're interested in doing what Vicki and I do 3 times a week? Well, the Obstacles of Podcast Training is offered by PWTRN. Go check it out at https://education. Or educate, try that first. PassionateWorldTalkRadio.com/masterclass. And you can learn how to do this and do it well and make money at it and get sponsors. But I'm letting you know right now, you got to work at it. And if you don't like working, well, then you use Ruby AI. And it will help you put out fantastic content for your podcast programs, which sounds pretty neat. Again, interested? Give me a call, 484-364-1032. And along those lines, Vicki and I have written a book on communication, on business, and a great book to pick up to help you become more successful at what you'll love to do. Because I'll tell you something, on podcasting, if you are doing a program, nobody can tell you to keep quiet. The only thing they can do is probably turn you off. But then they can turn you off without turning you off, right? They can put cotton in their ears. So there's all kinds of turnoffs. But please go and try it out. Thank you very much for listening. And before we go away and stray, we also help you write your memoirs. So if you want to get your wisdom out to the world, this is an ideal time to do it. Put it together for a Christmas present, a Hanukkah present, a New Year's Eve gift, especially if you're trying to dry them out from the previous year. So contact us at pwrnetworkllc@gmail.com. Leave us your details, name, rank, the usual. And either Vicki or I will get back in touch with you and help you get your set up so you can get your memoirs out to the world. And we will help you write it, which is even better. So think about that. Tune in for State of Current Affairs, Monday and Tuesday, live, 9 a.m. USA time, 10 p.m. Singapore time. Wednesday morning, 10 p.m. Singapore time, 9 a.m. USA time. And everybody in between, just add and subtract your numbers. I'm not going to do it for you. Google will tell you. And so will Ruby. Just say, hey, I live in the West Coast. What time is it available? We're usually seen live on YouTube and LinkedIn. And you can always go over to the website, https://passionworldtalkradio.com. Scroll down to the bottom of the page, State of Current Affairs, click on it, takes you to a page, click on the Google link, and it takes you into the belly of the YouTube beast. You can see all our previous episodes of State of Current Affairs, plus all the other videos and episodes from PWTRN. And you should have yourself a smorgasbord of listening to really good programs. So thank you very much for joining us. Have a great day, and we'll see you next time.